Yes, yeah, definitely 7:30. Right,
recording in progress.
Call the special meeting of the Board of Selectmen to order. The first order of business is public comment, and we ask the people to limit the comments to the agenda item, which is selection of a independent investigator. And we'll let people in the room speak first, and then we'll see if anybody online wants to. You don't have to.
I have a question, but I don't think it's related enough to the agenda. Common question, so maybe if I'll ask that one then.
It's not related to the investigation?
Maybe indirectly. I'm curious about the Park and Rec Commission process. Just want to get information about that.
It's not.
Might be in here as part of this.
Oh, you guys can go forward. Going forward with the commission,
yeah,
or
like what's the what? How one is? Who's deciding who's on it? When does that decision get made? What are those responsibilities?
I don't know for sure. I mean, the Board of Selectmen appoints the members, and there was a request or an idea that it not that names be solicited. So there was, I know it was in the Bethany bulletin that went out a couple weeks ago. So maybe it'll be brought up at the normal Board of Selectmen meeting in September. That would be the earliest they would. And it really depends on how many people apply, whether there's a lot of people and then we have to pick between them or.
I think in a way it is related to what we're doing because that might be, I don't know if it might be in here as part of the work that the investigator does. Because I think I remember saying something, but I think that one good question I have about that is, you know, is Paula the one that's going to choose who's,
yeah,
who the members are? So it's a good question. I mean, I would say she shouldn't be the one making this.
Yeah, that's not really a question for the investigator.
Well, whether or not she has authority to do that, but it might be. And as we go along, I remember making a note about that somewhere here. I have the video.
So I don't have the full information, but I would guess that at least it would be discussed, if not voted on at the we're in public comment. Did you have any public comment on the agenda item?
Well, this is the end of public comment.
Just
oh,
we're going to ask people online, but we're doing people online first.
All right, I'm just doing something.
Anybody online have a comment they'd like to share? I guess, do they have to raise their hands so you can unmute them?
They have the ability to unmute themselves.
Okay.
See what the chat's doing.
Does anyone online have a public comment? And they can hear us, right? Okay.
You should just ask the anything for an address, just so the minutes are clear.
Yes.
Okay.
Jillian Nugent, right?
Yes, my name is Jillian Nugent, Fuji, and my address is 53 Miller Road, Bethany, Connecticut.
Oh, thank you. Any other comments at this point, or?
Do you guys have everything from set up of what's going to be asked of the investigation?
You know, that's what we're going through tonight.
Is that something we're going to do tonight?
Yeah, we're working on putting together stuff that we had to work on our own because we can't work on stuff except in public meetings.
Right, does that make sense? That because this is a public meeting, Bob and I can't like work on it in between meetings. Even
we
though
have emails and I guess you have those, you know, the people that were going to contribute ideas to it.
I didn't get that.
I didn't get
any. So, I mean, I would say that if people have anything that they think of and they want to, I don't know if we'll be able to finish today. There's a chance that we might. But if people have ideas, you know, sending an email couldn't hurt. it's good to get feedback and, you know, what people think.
I have a friend that has a lot of ideas, so I'll tell her to send it all over.
Yeah, that'd be good. Yeah.
All right, so I know there were two things. Jen Capasso had drafted a scope of work just to get started on stuff. And then I put together some RFP language for the other stuff, but it's not the scope of work.
You know, I just want to say before we get started that I had sort of an objection to the way item three is worded on the agenda. It's the way it reads is discussion and possible action, preparation of scope of work and request for proposals for independent investigator for review of parks and recreation department. I just asked for a very minor edit. I asked that request for proposal be deleted because I don't see this as a request for proposal. You know, this isn't, we're not asking for, you know, a contractor to give us a quote on, you know, a project in town. We're not asking for a road to be paved, and I don't want to be bound by the lowest bidder. And I was told that we wouldn't be bound, and it has to be a, you know, request for a proposal. But then when I asked for the procurement policy, and people could have a copy of this if they want, it doesn't that say that if it's a request for a proposal, you're required to accept the lowest bidder. So I just wanted to be clear and let people know what was happening with this item. And again, I think that if Paula is recused, she shouldn't be forcing the agenda to be written a certain way. So, thank you.
Yeah, I'll say, I mean, there's no part, I mean, unless there's some local definition or, you know, whatever agency working with, there are really hard definitions for requests for qualification, requests for proposals, invitation to bid. Although usually when you say invitation to bid, it's more of a construction contractor approaches for price is the primary, you still look, they have to be qualified.
Right.
Usually,
and then
I know when there's federal funds involved, we're hiring engineers or architects, we are not allowed to talk about money. They have to do a request for qualifications, and then you select who you want to work with. You haven't talked about money at all, and then you negotiate. Because they don't want anybody to be affected. And I request a proposal somewhere in between. So if you're hiring a an accountant or attorney or something like that, I say request a proposal is just give us your qualifications, but also tell us what you charge, because that's not going to be the, may not even be the primary factor, but it may be something we consider, you know. There's two attorneys, you think they're both good, one's 200 an hour, one's 600. You might say, if they're both equally good, I'll go with the 200. Mm-hmm. So, but anyway, there's definitely language we put into the document later on that, not that we need it in there, but it definitely says we don't have to take the low bidder, we can throw them all out, we can accept anyone, we can, you know, basically whatever is in the best interest.
Yeah. But I just want to be clear, Paula, you know, I think Leslie sent me the procurement policy saying basically you're bound by this, it's an RFP, and I just want to push back on that and say we do not have to call this an RFP. I don't think it is an RFP. This is a unique situation. I don't think we're bound by this procurement policy. Do you think we're bound by it?
We're selecting from bidding anyway.
Well, no, that's what I'm asking, because I don't know your position on this, because we're not allowed to meet outside of, you know, the public meeting. But So can you tell us whether you want to be bound by the procurement policy?
Well, we're not necessarily going to take the little bidder on it because it's a professional service.
So why don't you just say we're not doing this and cross out RFP?
Well, you have to call it something. So if you want to call it something else, you can say request for letter of interest and then add all the other stuff in. I think it's kind of semantic.
I mean, we could just, this is, we're drafting something, we're not even sure we're going to be done with it. Why don't we just say preparation of scope of work for independent investigator?
No, what is the ad, like if we're going to advertise in the paper, what does the ad say?
Are we going to advertise in the paper?
Well, I thought you wanted to publicly notice it. You know, there was the town attorney and initially was going to, you know, he just solicited quotes from certain firms. And we still should notify the firms, but.
Yeah.
I thought at a previous meeting, you wanted it to be a publicly advertised.
I think we should do both, just to get the most exposure and.
So when you put the legal ad in, you have to call it something. You, and so if you request for, I mean, request for proposal, could just mean literally asking.
I don't want to call it that, I really don't, because it's going to be misleading. People are going to think that it's an RFP. If you say, if you use that language, I think it's going to be confusing.
You say request for letter of interest, and then just define letter of interest to include the qualification.
I think that's better, yeah.
Okay.
I think that's better.
Request for letter of interest?
Yeah. Although, you know, I do think we should reach out to the firms, and, you know, I think they're going to be required to submit a letter if we're reaching out to them, you know what I mean? It'd be a different sort of.
We want them to submit something.
Right, because they have to tell us about what their proposal, you know, what their plan would be, their timeframe and stuff like that. What they can charge.
Right, so that's, whatever they're sending, them to send us information. Resumes, probably hourly rates. But we could change it to request for letter of interest if the word proposal is off-putting.
I just think it's confusing. People are going to make assumptions about what that means.
This is to be letters of interest. All right, and then, and it's an independent investigation review is the topic. And then in that template that I was using, which again is for engineers and architects, the first heading was intent. Do you have the similar to what I had, a different?
You know, I shouldn't have redlined it, which
is right,
I, yeah, no, this is for you. Yeah, that's for you.
All right.
I think
so
just to make it easy.
Seeking involvement from the investigation review.
Do you want to read it out loud so people could?
Yeah. All right. So intent. The town of Bethany seeking a qualified firm or person to perform an independent investigation and review of what happened after a report of an alleged sexual abuse of several children by the council in the town's after school. I will try. After a report of an alleged sexual abuse of several children by a counselor in the town's after-school program run by the Parks and Recreation Department was made in 2022.
December
of 2022, that refers back to the report is what that date is referring back to. Also, if appropriate, if any person was made aware of or reported an allegation prior to December 22. I think that's pretty good. Yeah, the way I've written, I realized I needed to add something because I was saying that we want an investigation of the sexual abuse, but that's not really, we don't want to duplicate what the police.
We definitely don't. And I think that if there's any question, we have to be clear that this is not at all about the criminal case in any way. It's really about the town's response. So I think, you know, I think that if it's not clear, do you think it's clear? I mean, I think it's.
So you just have to give them. I'm assuming what was reading, you know, right? What was reading is not familiar with it, what's going on. They may be from farther away, and all right.
So
second item
is just like a general statement about what this is and what the investigation is. Do you think we have to say explicitly this is not at all related to any crime or investigation of any crime?
No.
Okay.
I don't think so.
I mean, I think the rest of it explains that, you know.
Second item is background. Do you want to, did you use what I had sent as the model?
I did, yeah. And then I think it was.
But you made some edits.
Just a little bit. You know, I may have your original here. Do you know?
Yes.
So it's.
And we don't have to do this, but reading back through it, I was kind of thinking maybe just putting the first sentence or two in and then striking the rest of it is just providing too much information. Like, if they're doing the investigation, they don't need us to tell them every day.
I kind of like the background section.
Well, no, yeah, I did the background, but then I like said certainly the first part, which currently reads, town residents became aware of allegations of sexual abuse from news media reports in late June 2024 as a result of a press release by the Connecticut State Police announcing several arrest warrants served on the defendant, comma, Anthony Mastrangelo, in May and June of 2024. And then this is a note to ourselves to refer the reader to the arrest warrants, either attaching them or by providing a link to the State Police website. And then you've got reportedly the Bethany Community Schools notified by the Department of Children and Families in December 2022 that a complaint had been filed about Anthony Mastrangelo, a counselor in Parks and Rec after the school program, and an intern and substitute teacher at BCS. Reportedly, BCS informed the Parks and Rec Department immediately of this information. Reportedly, the defendant, it goes on from there. I was like, you know something? I've actually heard different stories from people, and this is kind of what we're asking the investigator to. So instead of us telling him, I was thinking after that first sentence, and the link or reference to the arrest warrant to that.
Okay, so where it starts reportedly, the, you know, Bethany Community School.
Yeah, so I was thinking reportedly the Bethany Community School and the Park and Rec Department were notified in December 2022 that a complaint had been filed with the Department of Children and Families about Anthony Mastrangelo, a counselor at the Parks and Recreation After School Program, and an intern and substitute teacher at BCS, and then striking the rest of it.
Hold on a sec. I just want to read what you're proposing to strike. Reportedly, BCS informed the Park and Rec Department immediately of this information. Reportedly, the defendant was immediately removed from employment at the school and with the after school program. Reportedly, the defendant was immediately removed from employment at the school and with the after school program. That sentence doesn't make sense. The school grounds. Anyway, that's not grammatically right. At an unknown time, he was removed from the Park and Rec Department, although he remained employed by the Parks and Rec Department until June 2023. At some later date or dates after December 2022, initial notification by DCF, town and school officials may have received additional information regarding the allegations such that the complaint was about sexual abuse and more than one minor victim was involved, and that DCF had referred the case to the state police for criminal investigation. Reportedly, the defendant sexually abused another child in a private home in May
2024. I think they need that background.
I can't speak. It's not wrong. I just realized that I was repeating things that I had heard. I mean, I guess the investigator's going to have to do their own thing and not rely on me telling them what happened, because I don't know.
It's important to know that they need that background.
So that's why the word reportedly ends up in front of everything, because
that's,
I don't know to be fact.
They need to know that.
I mean, it's not really wrong. I was just saying, you know, I was going to just stop it.
It's going to take longer to investigate that.
You said there was a sentence in here that needs some.
Oh, yeah, where it says kind of in the middle of the school grounds, that sentence just isn't right grammatically.
Reportedly, the defendant was appointed at the school and with the after school program, and with the after school programs, period. And with the school grounds. Background.
Maybe just delete the school grounds.
Yeah.
I don't think the arrest warrants are online anymore.
Oh, that's a problem.
I have them.
Okay. Then we'll have to attach them.
I have them.
Okay. So
I can scan them and
they should be attached then. So then it'll just say, please see the arrest warrants attached.
Yeah.
I mean, it's easier, they don't have to go looking for something there, or potentially have a dead link.
So just in order to make forward progress, why don't we just put like a question there and then get back to it a little later? Because I want to get through as much of this as we can.
Yeah, so the only thing we did is we struck school grounds.
Yeah, just school grounds. I think like when I was looking at this, I thought that the background was helpful to someone who may not know anything about.
I was just, when I went through it again, I was kind of like, well, you know, why am I telling them what everything is? And then this was totally just put stuff in that residents concerned with, that was just putting in things that I heard. I don't know whether that should be, I left it, I don't know whether that should be in there or not.
Wait,
just as a, where we I listed a couple of residents' concerns.
I like the residents' concerns, and I actually have.
And it's just part of the background that kind of frames it kind of into the,
yeah.
Why did the state police investigation take 18 months? Why didn't the school and town notify parents?
Now, before you go any further,
yeah.
I think that the town concerns, that's the whole point of this,
yes.
Right? So I was looking through some of my notes from town meetings and stuff, and that's where these questions came from.
Mm-hmm.
So I wasn't sure, you know, I didn't really have time to plug it in, but maybe we can look at what's here.
If there's so many, do we want to put those as an attachment? These are, you know, not like we're assigning you to do this, but these are some questions that we've received that the public has had, and
And we can just you know, let people know, and some of it might be a duplicate,
redundant.
But
more is just like background, not like this is your scope work. Only answer that particular questions that somebody have, you know, this somebody sent, but just to give like these are the things that people are not sure about, so that. The first three things were kind of about the town's actions, and then
you
the
know,
second three.
I hate to go backwards, but for the intent, the first section, I think we have to explicitly say that this is an investigation about the official response.
Investigation of, instead of what happened, the town's response to a report.
Yeah, because if you want to know what happened, that's very different than getting details about who knew what, when, and what the response was. So it's kind of like a different question.
Yeah.
So I think just instead of saying this is an investigation
happened,
review of what happened,
of
official
town,
response or
the town's response. In this case, it you know, it's very broad. It could include the town, including the school, the town's response.
Yeah.
I mean, it's. So as I was saying down here, that the first three questions posed were just generally like about the town and school release of information. Did they receive additional information? And then the second three I had written.
Wait, did you read number three?
No, I was just classified. We'll go back. Then,
okay.
Like the second three I was reading was more about, because other people said, well, how did it happen? What was there something wrong in Park and Rec with their policies, procedures,
mm-hmm.
practices. So what was in place prior to that? Was that substandard? Were the changes made as a result? And then are those changes or are additional changes recommended? So kind of a different side of the town's response, and then the child protection programs, kind of in the two different areas. But we'll go back and read the questions. So,
right, and you know, they don't think we don't have to keep everything in this order, because I think you're right. It's like 4, 5, 6, 7 are all related. 8 all related to policies and procedures. That's like 5 questions, right? 5 areas right there of
mm-hmm.
concern.
It's too busy here. Yeah, Park and Rec policies and procedures before, after, and then. Should more changes advisable to
And I think the timeline is important here. Like, you know, this we have this something happened in December. When the timeline is really important, like
mm-hmm.
when, what actions did it take? How take and when?
Based
you know?
On what information was available at different times.
Right.
So let's read the ones, and these are not meant to be. It says residents' concerns include, so it's not meant to be the exclusive. You wanna read them or?
Yeah. Number three, did town and school officials receive additional information after December 2022 about the allegations, such as that the complaint was about sexual abuse, that more than one minor victim was involved, and that DCF had referred the case to the state police for criminal investigation? If so, so this is part of the timeline we're getting at. So if so, which officials received additional information and when was it received? If additional information was received, why didn't the school and the town notify parents of this information even in a vague manner? I added that.
I would take that out.
Why?
That adds like a judgmental.
Well, I want to talk about this.
Why didn't they notify the parents of this information? Why say a vague manner?
Okay.
Well, it just,
we
it
can
kind
take
of
out vague manner, but the reason why I really wanted something like this, like the question, why didn't families receive any notification in December from the school or from the town? And I think it's important because given some public comment at a recent meeting, I think there's a misunderstanding about whether or not a public official is allowed to say certain things. And I think that this report has to get at that because people are under the impression that that a town or a school is not allowed to make a statement. And so I'd like the investigation to cover that.
Yeah, I just think it's enough without putting
okay.
any subjective.
So
the question before, which I think we read specifically, was about the initial information or the December 22, and then the three is all about if additional information became available, and then if it didn't, then they wouldn't go on. But if it is, who received the information, then why didn't they?
Exactly. And this is consistent with what we've heard from town residents who have said, you know, that even if information wasn't known in December, well, when did the town have more information? So that it's part of the timeline, I think.
And then the 4, 5, and 6 are just the three different questions about policy, procedures, protocols, training, and practices related to sexual abuse in the Park and Rec Department. The first, number 4, is about prior to December 2022. 5 is about, you changed what I had written.
I mean,
you copied it.
Yeah.
But it was supposed to be the,
after,
yeah, after becoming aware of the DCF complaint and any additional information,
I'm gonna change 5 to say after instead of prior because they're the same. We have,
I think, yeah, so just strike 5,
so just,
it's already it's the same as 4. Then you had added 1, who took training classes and when, what employees, and exactly what training. Okay,
I mean,
so
I
that,
think there's like a couple, like 8, and there's only 6 on the original document, and there's 9 in this.
Right.
So
that's like a follow up question to the Park and Rec Department.
Right. We can move it up to 2 or 3 if you want.
Or maybe we'll put it after and then just say for all time periods, who in the Park and Rec Department took training classes, right?
Yeah.
So for all. Relevant time periods.
So, employees of Park and Rec, you know, do they take training classes? If so, when? Which employees, whether they're, full time or per diem, seasonal, part time, full time, exactly what training did they take? So that's number 6. And so then 7 goes back to the policies, procedures.
Yep, so that then 7 is the same question about.
That's 5. It's,
no, but then the timeline is after they became aware of the
complaint.
So in reaction to either the initial complaint or any additional information. And then you added some follow up questions about exactly when did Park and Rec make those changes, if any. Whose suggestion were they made? Who implemented those changes?
It should say, if anyone, who implemented the changes.
are any additional changes to policies or procedures related to sexual abuse recommended? So that's forward looking, all and whatever changes have been made, are there still some that are recommended? And obviously we don't know the expertise of the investigator in child protection.
Mm-hmm.
Could vary, but at least in their opinion, looking at things, is there anything that the new Park and Rec Commission and new director should be considering and implementing?
Mm-hmm.
So that was 8.
And then 9, what was the role of the Park and Rec Commission prior to December 2022? Was the Park and Rec Department notified about the allegation made against Anthony Mastrangelo? When did the Park and Recreation meet?
Commission,
yeah. When did they meet? Who were the members? What was their tenure? What was the mission, role? Do they have the ability to hire and fire? Did they meet with the first select woman? Did they meet with the director of Park and Rec?
So that was aimed at determining was the commission providing an oversight role, and and then not a number, a question, right? He's just returning to the end of the background. An independent, outside, unbiased investigation is desired because the first select woman is related by marriage to the director and assistant director of the Park and Rec Department, and has acknowledged the defendant's family is friends with her family, resulting in an actual or perceived conflict of interest. The director and assistant director and the defending counsel were not hired by the current first select woman. They held these positions prior to her being elected to that office. The first select woman has recused herself from the independent investigation. I, again, written because the reader may not be familiar with Bethany or what's going on here, and they might be like, you know, what's going on? You know, am I going to be hired by this first select woman? This just explains that why the first select woman is not involved in this process.
Yeah, and I think there's some stuff for us to clarify in terms of feedback that, because I think there's a section or two where we just said the board of selectmen, so we have to clarify that it's you and me.
But we're the board, and we're not a different board. So
well,
board
she's the board too, though. I think that you've kind of been
concerned when you say that. Yeah, it's the board, and she's not participating in this. She recused herself from this matter. So then, scope of work, I just said, following describes in general the anticipated scope of work, not meant to limit the investigation and review as it may develop. And then that's where I was thinking of putting.
Yes.
So
it's our draft currently says insert scope of work language here.
Because it was a separate document. But, now is this totally separate from what Jen prepared?
No, I think it's includes my my stuff.
So
we can work off of that.
So that I know on hers, I looked at it very quickly and it seemed like a general, I don't know whether she got it from the internet or whatever, but it definitely seemed like a general approach to a scope of work, like an employment investigation. I will say with the first one, so under scope of work, we have an objective to conduct a comprehensive, unbiased, and confidential investigation of the handling of the notification of an investigation of employee Anthony Mastrangelo, and to uncover the facts, assess any breaches of policy regulations, provide actionable recommendations. Again, this is like the general scope. I think we, if nothing else, we need to take out the word confidential, because while that would normally be something that management would want, they just want to, they're not going to publicize their employees' things in a private, in a private scenario, they want to know what to do about their employee or their manager or something like that. In this case, it's not going to be confidential because they're just strike
it. Yeah.
Any other edits on that section? And again, this is again, we're just saying, hey, we're trying to give you a general idea of what we're looking for, but in no way is this the whole. Right, limited to that.
Yeah, I mean, I actually, when I think about this, I've actually been trying to think of ways to make this more easier, more simple, right? Like, we don't want every, we just want answers to the basic thing, what's the timeline? But I think, I don't like the passive voice here. So it's to conduct a comprehensive, unbiased investigation of the handling, like who, right? Like what does that mean? Who handled it? Of the town's response. Because investigation of the handling.
Do you want to strike this section? Because we already have a background in.
No, I kind of like this. Right. I kind of like to insert that here under.
Mm-hmm.
But,
I'm going to leave it for now. Let's have specific edits.
I think we could take out action. I mean, that's subjective. What does that mean?
Oh, yeah. I think again, that's the generic.
Right. So,
yeah, we are actually not specifically asking for tell us what to do, right?
Right.
Really, like, should you fire this employee or, you know, that's not necessarily what we're looking for the recommendation, just the facts that the town can then decide what to do with.
Do you agree that we should say, instead of the passive voice, we should say the investigation of the town's handling of the notification of the investigation?
The town's. With all the other information, it should be okay.
So,
next section is entitled Scope of Work, Preparation, Review Initial Reports and Documents Related to the Incident, Develop an Investigation Plan, Outlining Key Steps, Timelines, and Resources Needed, Obtain Authorization and Brief from Relevant Authorities, Data Collection.
Now, I think we have to, it says the incident, and that's in the singular, and so we have to change that, because there's...
Yeah, did you change her thing? I don't know why it just says data collection. No, that's what she has. Oh, no, data collection is a heading for...
Okay, for the next, so I just need to space here.
So
yeah,
right. Actually, scope of work is a little tough. Scope of work is applying to all this stuff under here, right?
Right.
So preparation is one thing, data collection,
yeah.
Interviews.
Yeah, so
interviews should be the same as...
So the scope of work is in bold, and the rest of these headings shouldn't be, just to make it clear that this goes under scope of work. I think it'd be easier to read if it's like that. What do you think?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so now it looks like interviews is another thing after.
Yeah. Yeah. So this should be its own thing or indented or whatever.
So the preparation is like a subheading, and then mm-hmm. that's the initial reports, investigation plan, authorization and brief, and then data collection under the heading data collection. It's preparation, then data collection, interviews is under the heading, so shouldn't be bolded.
Right.
And then I see she has some separate lines, but you put them all together, the ones related to interviews.
Yeah, it was probably easier to read the way she did it. I can't remember if I added anything.
Identify and interview all relevant parties, including witnesses, complainants, and subjects of the investigation. the defendant's not gonna talk to them. Prepare interview questions in advance to ensure the interviews are conducted in a fair and unbiased manner. Record interviews with consent. Take detailed notes. Collect and review all relevant documents, emails, communications, and records related to the incident. Secure any physical or electronic evidence pertinent to the investigation. Examine any physical evidence relative to the incident, including locations, objects, and other tangible items. Analyze digital evidence, such as electronic communications, logs, and recordings. This is just like generic investigation. I mean, it's fine. Some of the stuff, maybe if there's no physical evidence, and there's just not relevant. But at this point, it's fine.
It might be a little overkill here, right? I mean,
so yeah, somebody ready to work for any kind of investigation, right?
Right. But I mean, I think we have three locations here where incident is singular, I think we have to use plural. Unless you want to change it to, if you want to change it, instead of saying incident, if you want to say the town's response.
There's that one, records related to the incident.
Yeah, it's all singular, but that, I think that's confusing, like what incident, is there one incident that, I guess the town's response could be it, but.
I think they'll understand this is a generic description only the applicant.
I don't think it should be generic.
Right, that's what we're trying to do.
It needs to be incidents, or there wasn't one kid.
But see, that's why it's confusing, because if this says incident, like there's one thing that happened, and there's been multiple, you know, allegations of abuse, and so I think it'd be probably more clear if we changed it to records related to the town response, you know, stuff like that, instead of, because this is not an investigation of any crime.
Yeah, or we could just strike related to the incident and just say, collect and review all relevant documents, emails, communications, and records, period.
Yes.
It just has to be relevant.
Yes. I think that's fine. That's good.
It's kind of duplicating it to say relevant.
Response as for the duration, as the initial response, and then the ongoing response, like current, present day?
Yes, the scope that's written here is just very generic, so it's hard to suddenly put specific.
That's a good question, because that's sort of what I was thinking when I was reading this. What incident is this directing us to? It's confusing. And so I think the way we just took out, you know, collect and review all related documents, period. That's okay, I think, because at least the confusion factor is not there. But we still have two other places where it says.
So where we started with the word collect, that really should be under a different heading than interviews. The three sentences before talk about interviews, and then there should be another heading.
Right.
Documents or something like that, documents and other evidence.
So these other two places where it says the incident, I think we should change that. Under scope of work, review initial reports and documents related to the incident. You want to just take it out again?
Yeah, relevant, or just do the same thing. Course are related and put initial relevant reports and documents.
Kind of understood, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
Reinitial initial reports and documents. Yeah, I mean, this, you have to stop assuming everyone's an idiot when they're reading it. I mean, they know what they're doing. All right, and then there's an analysis. Cross-check interview responses with documentary and physical evidence to identify consistencies and discrepancies, assess the credibility and reliability of information collected, determine whether any policies, procedures, or regulations were violated, evaluate the context and circumstances surrounding the incident. We got to change incident.
Yeah, we do.
Just put a period after circumstances.
I think we should say evaluate the context and circumstances surrounding the town's response. I had real questions, concerns about the next section. This is one I was going back and forth. I don't know if you want to skip it or just go, you know, in order since we're here. I was just thinking about how some of this stuff works at my work.
In the Jen's draft here, preliminary report summarizing initial findings and immediate concerns. Report through preliminary report, final report, draft the detailed report, executive summary, background, methodology, findings and conclusions, recommendations for corrective actions or policy changes, review and revise the final report based on feedback, ensure the final report is clear, concise, supported by evidence.
So,
I don't think that's necessarily wrong.
So, the reason I was going back and forth with this is that if we're, the town has concerns, the whole reason for this is that people want answers. So now we're in writing telling an investigator that we want to know how they're doing with their report and we're asking for a copy. And I think that that could appear that we're trying to influence what the report is saying. And I'm really concerned about that. So.
You don't call it a preliminary report? They submit a draft?
No. If they submit a draft, we're still sort of saying, or it can appear that we're saying that we want to influence what's in the report. Because what do you do with the draft? Do you comment on it?
Right.
And that's probably not appropriate for us to do. What we want is, if we really want an independent investigation, we shouldn't meddle with how they're doing or the, you know. I mean, you know, I think having check-in meetings where we say, hey, you know, because we don't want this to take a year, right? So the time frames have to be discussed, but I don't want the in writing or in reality or it to appear that I want to influence what the draft and what the final report is going to say, because I don't. And I think that if we keep that in there, it will appear that we are trying to influence what the report says or doesn't say. And so I think we shouldn't ask the investigator, whoever it may be, to check in with us in that way, and that we probably shouldn't ask for to look at a draft of the report that they're working on and building. Unless you can think of a reason why that would be.
Well, then you're going to get a report, and then that will be that. And if you're like, I don't like, you should have done, it's too late.
Well, that's why we have to take this part very seriously, right? We have to.
Well, yeah. So, I mean, you've got a list of questions here. What if they don't answer those questions? You wanted them answered. It's too late because you already said, whatever we get, we get, and we're not going to look at it.
Right. Well, I think we have to.
So, I think a draft, the way this is written, preliminary looks like they're looking for, you know, if they say where they were investigating an employee for alleged sexual harassment, it comes back, oh my God, there's 50 people complaining about them. You don't want to maybe wait till the final report, you know, suspend this person or something. We don't really have that situation here. So maybe we don't call it a preliminary report, but I think we're going to want to see a draft.
I don't know.
Because
it's those meetings. Those meetings are enough to make sure that, oh, are these questions being addressed, like an update?
Maybe. I mean, in any other context, you normally get a draft or comment.
Yeah. This is a unique situation, and I think we have to, this part has to be well done, and I think we have to put a lot of thought into this to make sure it's thorough, and then the decision on who is going to be given the job to do this work.
Right. Why don't we do it, we just leave it as we strike the preliminary.
Okay.
Now, the language that Jen had here is all the different sections, right? And then, so they're saying, it's confusing because they shouldn't indent anything. So under final report draft, the detailed final report, including executive summary, background of the notification, that's too specific. Just background. These are the headings for the report.
Right. I'm hoping that we're going to hire someone who has experience doing this and they don't need.
Right, but using background of the notification of the BCS superintendent in December 2022, that's
wait,
too
wait,
specific.
Okay.
It's too specific. Just say background. Methodology of investigation, findings, conclusions, recommendations. For corrective actions or policy changes, those are the headings that were the general topics. And then the next line is not a heading. Review and revise final report based on feedback. So they're going to give us a draft final report, and maybe we say good as is, or
I don't know. I don't think we can do that.
Why?
Because it's not our report. I mean, I think this is you know, the town, I think, I mean, this is my understanding, the town has concerns, and I don't think they want you and I to edit the town investigation.
The plan is made public as soon as it's released.
Oh, yeah, that was voted on, I think, as well. So I don't think.
Leave it the way it is.
Thank you, I forgot about that.
Yeah, leave it the way it is.
Excuse me, I have a question. Is the public comment, like, ongoing throughout this meeting?
No,
because I'm hearing. Okay, so why are we allowing?
I know you have difficulty, and please don't comment either. If the individual in the room is fast, I have to comment anymore. I think leave it the way it is. Are you worried about we're gonna do something to them?
Wait a minute, I'm not sure why you struck this.
Background of the notification of the BCS superintendent in December 2022, it's under the general headings of the report. Background, so executive summary, background, methodology. So don't strike back the word background, just strike the specific
right, but
stuff.
Where is that? Where, it's here, you're saying? It's in here?
Yeah.
This?
No, under final report.
Okay.
So you're saying that the final report should include, this is difficult, because then this is the list, executive summary, mm-hmm. background, and I'm saying the words after background are too specific for a heading, right?
Yeah, I think I put this in as a reminder that I wanted to ask you about what your thoughts were in terms of, it's in here already, I think, of, getting information in this investigation about what the school knew and what they did.
Yeah, that was included in some of those general questions. It was park and rec in the school. Back under background.
Okay.
Which is the list of things. But I think the last thing should be somehow separated from that list of headings.
Yeah.
Review and revise the final report based on feedback. So if they have not followed the scope, that would be where we would tell them.
So here's the problem that I just was reminded. There was a public meeting where someone made a motion and it passed, and the motion was stated that the board does not have an opportunity to look at the report or comment on the report or request edits to the report. So I think we'd be in violation of that, and I don't know if you want to tickle it or mark it and review it, but.
Well, I mean, if it's not an approved report, then it's a nothing. Yeah.
No, the whole point is there was a public meeting, there was a motion that was approved, and the motion was that we don't have an opportunity to comment or amend or ask for a revision or reject the draft even. That was my understanding of that. But I mean, we can go back and look at that.
Yeah, I would leave it the way it is. I think you're going to want to see some kind of draft. Otherwise, if people are not happy with it, there'll be nothing we can do.
Who's the people?
Please stop. Lack of responses. All right, recommendations. Provide actionable recommendations based on the findings. Do we want to not say actionable? Just say recommendations.
Yes, definitely.
Suggest corrective action, discipline measures, or policy.
Well, no. Wait a minute. I think we have to strike this line at the top of the page.
It's, you don't need to say it. Should be clear, concise, and supported by evidence.
Well, I mean, the line is related to the final report, and it says ensure that the final report is clear, concise, and supported by evidence. So this is us inserting ourselves, saying we're going to make a judgment and we're going to decide whether this report is valid or not.
No, this is a scope of work for the contractor. We take it out.
I think we should take it out because I don't think it's too subjective.
Hopefully that's what they're going to be doing anyway.
Yeah.
Recommendations. Provide recommendations based on the findings. Suggest corrective actions, display measures, or policy changes as appropriate. Recommend preventive measures to avoid similar incidents in the future.
I don't like
it. They're kind of generic.
Yeah, I don't like the phrase similar incidents. I think
recommend preventive measures if the future is implied.
Right. What do you think about something like recommendations to our guidelines for future communications with town residents? I'm just trying to think. Let me just tell you in plain language what I'm thinking about. I think that if we had, let's say, hopefully not, I mean, really, everybody's traumatized, but in 6 months or a year or 5 years from now, we have a similar situation. We're in a similar situation where either at the school or in the town hall building or a town employee is accused of something serious, there's an investigation. What does the town leadership do with that information? And I think that it would be helpful to have some guidance on what a proper reaction is, and whether or not how communication should be made to the town residents if those things happen. And I think that is really important. And so I really want to focus on how to word this.
Versus, I mean, you know, obviously the generic stuff, policy changes and preventive measures, it would be included, but you want to be more specific.
I think at least for the
line at the end is more specific about communication, recommendations for improvements, and communication.
Guidance regarding
using the communication protocols.
Regarding proper communication protocols. Timelines. Guidance regarding proper communication protocols. I'm trying to think of language like when this happens, like, you know, I want to say, like, specifically if there's an investigation, for example, guidance regarding proper communication protocols.
But you don't want to say so.
In response to.
Similar circumstances.
Yeah, I mean, something like that. Guidance regarding proper communication protocols in response to
similar issues.
And similar issues, I think it'd be better to be more specific, like in response to notifications. How about town notifications of a pending investigation? I don't know if this is worded well because that might, but I think this is really important to have some feedback on that. There's been a lot of confusion in town with, you know, Paula saying that she was legally prohibited from saying anything at all in December. And I think that this is important guidance for us to have some clarity on that.
We need to provide guidance.
Yeah.
I recommend guidance regarding proper communication protocols for town notification of pending investigations.
Yeah, something like that is good. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and I mean, this is just these things are to get out there and advertise and try to get some responses. Obviously, when we're reviewing them, depending on what we're looking for, we'll have to kind of go back and look at what their scope of work is, because that may impact who we want to hire.
Right.
In other words, if someone is a very good private investigator, detective, they may not be the right ones to provide legal guidance to the town on, you know, how far the rec department should be run, you know.
Right.
But very good at interviewing people and requesting documents.
Yeah, and that's why that's the difficulty in this is that we're writing it for a general audience and not to a specific, you know, investigator. Is it going to be an investigator? Is it going to be a law firm? Is it going to be, you know, somewhere in between? Hopefully someone who's done, you know, a serious investigation before. But, so I think...
I think that would be mandatory.
Right. No, I agree. Yeah. So I think that you've raised an interesting point, which means that we might have to show some flexibility in terms of when we start talking to people and how,
Yeah, definitely.
Like, it's not every single sentence here that we're talking about tonight is going to apply to every single person who might be interested in taking this on, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So should we go to follow-up?
Yeah.
Follow-up. Establish a follow-up plan to ensure recommendations are implemented. Monitor the effectiveness of corrective actions and make adjustments as needed. Conduct follow-up interviews or reviews if necessary to verify compliance with recommendations. So this is in here, but I just wanted to ask you, like, do you think this is the role of an investigator, or is this something for the town to follow up on? Like, once we get the report,
there is scope for work to be done. Establish a follow-up plan, maybe. But they're not going to monitor the effectiveness, and that goes beyond.
I think that's more for the town to do that.
Just to strike the section. They're not responsible for a follow up.
I think I strike the whole thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Communication. That one.
Maintain regular communication with the board throughout the investigation. Ensure confidentiality and handle all information sensitively. Provide updates on the investigation's progress and any significant developments. So we have a lot of work to do here, right?
So this is the part where they should be making some kind of progress reports, not just working for 2 months, 3 months, and dumping a report on us, and then we realize they veer off wanted.
Well, we have to take out the board because the board includes Paula, and we can't leave it like that.
No, it's fine.
No, it's not.
We're not a different entity. We're the board of selectmen.
Well, we could say selectmen 2 and selectmen 3. I mean, I could get into an accident tomorrow and I'll be replaced. So
I would receive it as the board.
I don't feel comfortable with that because it implies that Paula's involved.
But we've already said earlier on that she's...
Right, but all sections of the document should be consistent with each other. And, you know, I'm not really sure why, you know, do you want to...
Well, as I say, we're not a different committee or something like that. We're the Board of Selectmen. And Paul is not here because there's nothing on the agenda.
All right, so what if we say maintain regular communication
later on, it means the fact that they're not communicating with us individually. It's probably going to have to be through, say, Jane Cabasso or...
No, I thought about that. We can't do that either. Maintain regular communication with the board, except for the person who's recused. I cannot, like, inconsistencies are going to not... They're
just
not...
After that sentence, they're just provide the same information again. No, the first selectman has recused herself from this investigation.
That's fine. The confidentiality thing is appropriate. I mean, certainly the investigator shouldn't be, you know, talking to everybody about.
Yeah, I think later we'll make it clear that it's public, but they don't have to tell everybody everything that somebody else Yeah.
So I don't have a problem with that. The last sentence with under communication, I think.
Provide updates on the progress and any significant developments. Strikes significant developments, just updates.
Do you have, this reminded me of like timeline, like how much time do you think an investigation like this requires? Because I think, you know, if we talk to people and they say, I need a year and a half, I think we could say, wait.
After we finish scope of work, when we get back to the generic proposal or whatever stuff,
right.
I had put in asking them for schedule, but then I wasn't sure, maybe we shouldn't ask if, if they're really just not familiar with it. But I guess we could say, what schedule do you anticipate?
Mm-hmm.
Like if they're coming in to it saying, this will be a 2-year thing, that firm may not be thinking of the same thing that we are.
Right.
But if, whatever they tell us, somebody tells us 4 weeks, that doesn't mean it's going to be 4 weeks.
Right.
So maybe we just ask them in general, at this point, based on what do you anticipate the schedule to be, the length?
Right. Or given your case, your workload, when,
if they're like, I'm real busy for the next year, then
right.
I'd be happy to work on it.
Yeah.
Not going to help us.
All right. So we added the thing
about the first select woman recusing. You want to change the last sentence?
I just don't know. I don't know if I want to strike the whole thing or just.
Provide updates on the investigation period.
It gives me the sense that we're asking to meddle in the investigation in a way. I mean, provide updates.
Well, I guess, especially like if they're submitting bills that we have to approve, you have to know what they did. Like, I don't think they have to say so and so said this and so and so said this, and I found this email. I mean, they could just say, I've interviewed, 6 people, but I've identified 12 that I want to.
How about just stop after the progress? Updates on the investigation progress.
Yeah. Again, this is super generic, so it's a little bit over-inclusive. Confidentiality and legal compliance. Ensure all investigation activities comply with legal and regulatory requirements. I don't know how you can not do that, but it doesn't hurt to put it in, but they have to, just says follow the law. Maintain strict confidentiality, protect privacy of individuals involved. I mean, I guess that's okay during the investigation, but back and store all evidence and investigation records securely. Do you want to just add a clarification at the end that or maybe we'll go down in your final report where a couple sections ahead to present to relevant stakeholders, and then that we should probably change and make it clear that the report's going to be released to the public and available to the public.
Yeah.
If that's the case, the confidentiality stuff is just during the investigation.
Right.
Do you have any other edits on that section?
I don't.
All right, next section is entitled Documentation and Record Keeping. Keep detailed record of all investigation activities, including interview notes, evidence collected, and communications. Seems okay, right?
Mm-hmm.
Ensure proper documentation of investigation process and findings, store investigation records securely in accordance with organizational policies. Just maybe store them securely. I don't know what the organizational policies are, so.
Yeah, just securely. I think
it doesn't really add anything else.
No, it doesn't.
But again, if we were such and such corporation, then we would have organizational policies for deliverables. Preliminary report, we're striking that, right?
Yes, please.
Okay. So it's just final comprehensive report detailing investigation process, findings, conclusions, and recommendations presented to relevant stakeholders. Just strike that part and then just let's put information in here about the final report will be public or something like that.
I think you know, I think the idea of this first sentence is just to give some information about what we are hoping to see in the report. I mean, it's already in another section, so I don't think it's crucial, but,
mm-hmm.
You know.
They presented to the relevant stakeholders, like, too generic.
Yes.
And somehow I want to, like, make it clear that the final report will be released to the public.
Let's just say that instead of this, because this is...
Instead of relevant stakeholders.
Yeah.
Action plan. I don't know. I think that's already been included in the recommendations are already included in the final report, right? There's not a separate thing.
No, we can strike it.
Just so
we're clear about that. If this section says action plan recommendations for corrective actions and policy changes, follow up plan to ensure implementation and compliance. So these are things we've already dealt with. And believe it.
Well, approval and sign off. I'm going to just write down the section.
Let's read it. That's my sense, and that's why I highlighted the word preliminary report. You want to review and approval of the investigation plan, which we're not going to do. Preliminary report and final report by relevant authorities. So that's definitely that whole thing we have to strike, right?
Yeah, I'm getting all the
okay.
Yeah.
Formal sign off to ensure all parties understand and agree to in the investigation scope, objectives, and findings. The scope of work ensures a thorough, impartial, and systematic investigation of reports of the incident on December 2022, and all actions taken thereafter, including but not limited to who knew, what he, she, they knew, when he, she, they knew, and what was done after the initial report by whom and when. Providing clarity on the facts and guiding your organization towards appropriate actions and improvements.
But this is under heading approval and sign off.
Yeah.
I don't think any of that stuff belongs under that. The first two things were like a, you know, don't proceed to get approval, but I think we've already got the scope of work and
you know, this scope of work here though, this section here I think is better than what we have. Just this section here.
We move it to another part of the scope.
Yeah. And
to strike the second sentence as well. So
yeah.
We're not gonna have a section
approval
and sign off.
No. Right.
Again, that's in the generic. But so you've got sentence, this scope of work ensures a thorough, impartial, and systematic investigation, reports of, and I know you don't like the word incident, so you might want to change it.
Yeah. Yeah, of the incident, we changed to.
An incident in 2017, incident or incidents, and all actions taken thereafter. Reports of sexual abuse, reports of sexual abuse in December 22, instead of incident, all actions taken thereafter.
What did you want to say?
Replaced reports of the incident in December 22 with reports of sexual abuse in December 2022.
Well, no, because that's confusing. It sounds like we're investigating the sexual assault.
Right, right.
So we have to be, that's why this is really confusing and the word incident is problematic.
But do we need this or do we kind of already?
I think we should change it to this, the scope of work ensures a thorough, impartial, and systematic investigation of the town's response starting on or about December 2022. Or the town's response.
Maybe just the scope of work should ensure a the scope of work. The scope of work should ensure a thorough and partial and systematic investigation period. And we'll move it back to the other parts.
That,
and then we don't have to repeat all the stuff about December 22.
Let's do that because we already have this covered earlier. So I'm going to delete.
So the scope of work.
Although I do like this after actions taken, all that part, that end of the sentence there, I think that's good.
All right, then we have to, the scope of work should ensure some impartial of the reports of the incident. So the reports received in December 22 and all actions taken thereafter.
No, we have to say the town's response, I think, because reports received is too confusing. I don't even know what that means.
All right, so systematic investigation of the town's response.
I thought you wanted to delete this.
I was, but then you wanted the rest of the sentence, so we have to leave it in, though.
We could just make it two sentences.
Okay.
Yeah.
So then we'll go back to
this.
The scope of work should ensure a thorough, impartial, and systematic investigation, period.
Or we could say systematic investigation, including all actions taken, all actions including but not limited to, and just tie in the end of that sentence.
Okay. Systematic investigation, including but not limited to?
Yeah. So now that's really neat because you just delete that middle part and.
Including but not limited to all actions taken. Oh, no, we already have an including. But just, do you want to just then, including but not limited to who knew what they knew?
Yes. Yeah, that way we don't have to.
And so we're focusing up to there. And taking out the reports of the incident.
Yes, and all the way to thereafter.
Yeah,
I think that's the easiest way to do it.
All right, the final sentence reads, now the scope of work should ensure a thorough, impartial, and systematic investigation, including but not limited to who knew, what he, she, they knew, when he, she, they knew, what was done after the initial report, and by whom and when.
Yeah.
And then the next sentence, I don't know if that follows, providing clarity and facts and guiding, straight that last sentence.
Yeah.
So this is very generic.
Yeah.
All right, now this sentence that we just came up with should be
moved up all the way
back to scope of work, right?
Yeah.
Like the general part in the beginning, we're talking about scope of work on page one.
Yeah.
Maybe just right under the heading scope of work.
Yeah.
Before you get into the detail.
Yeah. And then the details
follow.
Add from last page.
Yeah, that's right.
Add from last page.
Add to page. All right, so we may pass through the scope of work. So then we're up to submission and deadline.
Yeah. The bottom of the page.
Proposals, we're going to change that to letters of interest. Everywhere it occurs. Letters of interest will be received by the town of Bethany Board of Selectmen until 4 p.m. This is going to have to change, but that was the date I picked at the time.
Right.
Until, and we'll have to set a date.
Yeah.
4 paper copies of the proposals that now will be changed to. The first place we do letter of interest, let's put in parentheses LOI and then just use LOI. Four paper copies and or a PDF copy.
Yeah.
I don't care. Do we just want a PDF copy or leave it the way it is?
I mean,
the town staff can scan it if we receive paper copies.
Yeah.
All proposals should be signed. Proposals should be submitted to.
I think we have to change this. And look, this is nothing against Jen Cavasco. I think she's done amazing work with all the stuff that people said at the Board of Finance meeting yesterday that everything goes through her desk, and so it's impressive. But I think that it would be inappropriate to have her handle really any part of this, because she's Paul's assistant. And so I think it'd just be, it would be.
So that's literally, so strike her name and title, and just say Town of Bethany Board of Selectmen.
Well, I mean, I put a note in here, like right underneath, just because I was thinking of ideas on what to do.
So obviously that the mailing address is there. Is there an email address that they can be sent to?
I think that it should be our emails.
Okay.
Yeah. I really don't see any other way. And I think if something comes in on paper, the town staff should be instructed that they shouldn't open the mail unless we're there, or however you want to do it. That's what I would.
That's making it very complicated, because we don't work at the town hall. So it's going to be.
Yeah, but we live, you know, 3 minutes away. I don't know. I was just trying to address.
All right.
You know,
you don't want her to collect them, so strike her name and title.
Yes.
Okay. And then.
I want to be clear. I'm not saying that she's not capable. I think she's capable. It's just I'm trying to avoid any appearance of.
Well, let's go back. Right now, we're allowing people to either submit it by mail or by email. Do you want to leave both choices, or do you want to eliminate the choice?
I mean, I'm happy to leave both choices.
Okay. So they can either mail it to the Town of Bethany Board of Selectmen at 40 Peck Road, Bethany, Connecticut, 06524, or they can email it to selectmen2@bethanyct.com and selectmen3.
Sure, yeah.
And do you want to have them? So we're going
to
do selectmen.
I think it would be helpful if we could add our emails to the town website. Do you know how does that work, do you know?
I don't know. I was thinking the same thing. We have these emails, but
right.
Unless somebody knows it, it's
right.
Like
right.
A secret.
Right.
Do you want anyone who works at town hall to also receive the things, or just the two of us? So paper. So we're giving the mailing address, and then we're striking Jen Cavasso, the email address, and putting selectmen2@bethanyct.com and selectmen3@bethanyct.com.
Okay. So what's going to happen if someone sends something and says Board of Selectmen? No one's going to know what it is, and it'll be open. I have concerns about that.
Then the
proposal is going to be hand delivered and then open at Board of Selectmen.
Yeah, but
if there's mail that says,
yeah, so it has to be,
selected,
it has to be, then we'll have to put under that mailed LOIs must be in a sealed envelope. Clearly labeled. Letter of interest. And then what's it called? Independent letter of interest, independent investigation and review.
Yeah.
Context on how you get the mail.
Yeah.
Usually, like, if it just says Town of Bethany, a lot of times it would be a check for the tax collector, it would be for anyone, so something in the town clerk's office, we do have to open it to see what it is. In general, anything that are bills, anything that's for the Selectmen's office, or things that are just in general for the town, if you admit it's not clearly for us or for the tax collector, we're going to file that we give to Jen. So yeah, if they are able to very clearly write on the outside of the envelope that this is for this purpose, you can set it aside if it comes in. If it says town that we usually, it's not clear, then we're going to open it.
Right. Thank you for that. That's really helpful. Do you mind sharing this with people in the office?
Yeah.
And that's what's done in the sealed bids is it has to come in, it has to be, because otherwise it's going to get open.
Right.
And then say that the LOIs will be opened at a board of selectmen meeting.
Unless we're, do you want to? If we're both available, we can just not have to wait.
Two of you cannot be at the public meeting.
I forgot. Thank you. See, very helpful. Thank you. I appreciate it. It just seems.
But that's not something we need to put in the scope of work. That's our process.
Right.
They need to, if they're going to email it, they email it to Selectmen to and. Maybe we should make it capital and Selectmen 3 and mail letter of interest must be in sealed envelopes, clearly labeled letter of interest, independent investigation review, which would hopefully get.
Well, I think the heads off, well, people might be like looking out for that. So I think that would be helpful. Yeah.
Keeping on that. And then proposal shall contain the following and that we change to LOIs. And then here's what I was thinking.
I have a question that I need legal advice on. So since you've been so helpful, I feel inclined to ask more questions. So we're at the next Board of Selectmen meeting. We are handed sealed a couple of sealed envelopes. So then what? What happens?
Put in the proposal that. Received by next day, it will be opened at the next regular scheduled Board of Selectmen meeting, and then a decision will be made no later than this evening. And it could be that meeting, or you could set the date after the meeting to open the bids.
So this is like we have to go back and choose a date on the previous page.
We don't have to pick a particular date.
Well,
if we do, we're going to be bound by it.
Right. But I mean, it's probably
the
not
the difficulty with that. See, like if so, Jen got them, we could come pick up copies from her and review them ahead of time. Now, the way we set it up, we will not be able to see all of the. You'll be able to read any of the email, but the paper ones will have to have a meeting. So we can see. I mean, it'll work.
Thank you.
So then, if you're asking for sealed bids, you should not be opening that piece of meat to come in.
Well, they're not really bids, and we're saying we're going to take them by email.
Well, they're not necessarily sealed on there.
Right.
I thought there was some discussion about sealed bids.
Well, the concern that was expressed was they don't want town staff to open the envelopes. So that's why we're putting a label on them and saying it should be sealed and try
like
to
the
label
mail ones.
In a way.
So I'm not attention Bob went to the engineer to check the sure. Sorry.
That's okay.
Yeah, because we had in the draft it said care of Jen Cavasso and then in her title we could say care of Robert Burton and Jane Texera.
Yeah, that makes it better then because the sealed envelope thing might get.
Strike the thing about the sealed envelope.
Yeah. But then what happens, can I ask you a question about mail? If we get mail, it's open, isn't it? Does the town? I've gotten mail, and I can't remember if it's open or not.
If it comes in for you two, which really isn't often, if it comes in for you two, we usually put it in the fair. I can't think that ever happened really. But if we do get mail, you know, knowing this, if we do get mail that has your name on it, you can set it aside. You know,
but I know there's a mailbox. I used to check it. I haven't checked it in a while. I did get mail there once. It's near where the conference room is. there's a mailbox there. It says
mail machine. Is there?
Yeah, it says.
If it does say to you two, then knowing this, we'll keep all that aside.
Okay.
We very rarely get a number of messages.
Just our names.
That's just one name. Yeah. So just to finish my question about, we get delivered envelopes at a meeting. How do we deal with Paula, who's recused? How do we deal with her?
Down to the dais and remove herself from the table. She would be in the audience.
Okay.
Just to go back, I mean, look, if we put in the proposal is in a sealed envelope, that is generally understood to mean that it's got to be in a second inner envelope sealed.
But at least we're not doing that, though. Yeah.
I mean, you're asking how to ensure that nobody else, if they open it inadvertently, you know, it's still preserved pretty fast. Putting in the scope here.
So,
sealed envelope.
So, is it your recommendation that if it's mailed, it should be in a sealed envelope?
Mailed or hand delivered, yes, should be in a sealed envelope marked in response to our theater request and permit.
But then you can't allow it to be sent by email.
Email is unusual for an RFP.
Right. But this is not an RFP.
An RFP is a standard phrase for an investigation, such as
a. Well, I mean,
we don't have to strike the
email. I was emailed the procurement policy right away as evidence that I needed to call this an RFP. And
you'd like to call it something else, that's fine. You put it on the. I just used RFP, but on the. In the instructions, you would tell the bidder to mark the sealed envelope proposal or response to X, the term that you have used, LOI, RFP, or proposal, whatever term.
Oh, okay. That's helpful.
So you avoid, you know, it getting commingled with anything else.
Right.
So
we'll go back to the label.
We'll put the care of our names and leave the thing in. And, it was a good point. I said mailed, otherwise it should be paper, right? If we are
mailed, paper submissions,
whether they're hand delivered or mailed or FedEx or
right.
Whatever.
Right. So paper.
Paper. And
you
I was
can actually write and not you can specify no email.
What's that?
You can specify.
Should we know?
I think you either want it sealed or you don't want it sealed, right?
We can take the email.
Well, see, the sealing wasn't really the point. We were like. It wasn't our main goal. Wasn't to have the sealed submissions. We just wanted to make sure that there was some way that people in the office would know not to open the envelope because that's what they do, right? They open it. So it's not really that we wanted that we're insisting on sealed submissions. Do you think would it cause any kind of problem if some are emailed and some are submitted to us?
I only put that because it was in here for Jen Capasso and we changed his life into it. We could take email out of it. I'll ask them in paper. We're going to get four copies we asked for so that you and I can each take a copy and, you know, review it. And then there'll be additional copies that we file.
I think it's just an issue of management, how you guys feel more comfortable managing it. Coming in two different ways, maybe. Difficult to manage, but it's up to you.
Yeah, let's take email out because then we're going to end up having to print the things out of printers.
I don't really like the printer. I think that, you know, for some, you know, in this digital world, it seems odd to be taking out the electronic submission, you know, when we should try
to make
it easy as possible.
It does make it complicated. We're saying. Yeah, it makes it. I mean, when it was Jen Capasso was going to get them, and I guess four of those, but if they're like, we don't trust anybody at town hall.
That's not what I said.
Well, that's nobody else can get it.
No, that's not what I said. I didn't say I didn't trust anyone. I went out of my way to say that I thought Jen doesn't, wears many hats and is absolutely capable. My whole goal was to avoid. Putting anyone in a potentially an uncomfortable situation or appearing that Paul, who's recused, now has her assistant doing all of the work on this. I think
let's take email out now because
you could say, Bobby, you could say send them all to Gina. And I'll print them all at home.
The problem is with this home stuff, it's all public documents. How does anybody get them? They're only accessible to us.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we have to take the email out and just say paper. And then we're just asking for them to be like treated like a
bid. Right.
Treated like a bid, not to be open until the meeting. No, but treated like a bid.
Okay.
And it's all right, so four is four the right number? I just picked it arbitrarily. Once we have to strike four paper copies.
Where are the four copies going? Me, you, what do we do with that ones?
There should be a copy left in the town hall for records.
I don't know.
Yeah.
Can we have some advice on that? Oh, I'm sorry. We were trying to think about how many copies to request with the submissions. So one, two, and do we need another one?
One. Council to review it, request three, it's just the two of you reviewing.
But should there be copies left in the town hall?
Yes, yes.
Where would the town hall copy go?
You can designate whoever you designate to receive it. Like for you, send it to the finance director, clerk, tax clerk.
But why is there a need to do that? I mean, is there a file cabinet for, you know, investigation?
I don't know your file cabinet.
I don't either. No.
So, look, it's a public record, so the town needs to be copy of it in case there's a request in the future for it. If the two of you are the only one that had it, then that must bother you to get a copy. So, yeah, a copy should be maintained. Most likely,
but we'll leave the four copies. Because if we're the selection committee, we're going to want to take them. Assuming it's a lot, we're going to want to take them home to read them. Leave the other ones here. So four paper copies of the letter of interest are required. Strike the thing about PDFs. LOIs shall be signed, they shall be submitted to. Four paper copies of a letter of interest are required.
Mm-hmm.
So I struck PDF copy.
Yeah.
All instead of proposals, but I'm substituting letters of interest shall be signed. And then proposals shall be submitted to, and saying letters of interest shall be submitted to. And the address, Town of Bethany, Board of Selectmen, care of Robert Brenton and Gina Texera, 40 Peck Road, Bethany, Connecticut, 06524. We're going to strike all the email addresses.
Yeah.
Then we put a sentence in that says, we don't even need to say paper now, it's wrong paper. Letters of interest must be in sealed envelopes, clearly labeled letter of interest, independent investigation and review.
Mm-hmm.
Should minimize the chance of it being opened before the selectmen's meeting. So our policy is we can open it slightly. I don't know if we have to put that in here. We could add that just for their information.
Sure.
LOIs will be open at a board of selectmen meeting. That will go right after that.
Okay.
Yeah, LOIs will be open at a board of selectmen meeting. And then we'll get into number five, substitute letters of interest for the word proposal. Letter of interest shall contain the following. And I think that was something. So letter of transmittal, letter should be a brief discussion of the proposers of. What noun do you want there? of the
investigators.
Yeah. Yep. Background experience and ability to perform this contract. The letter of interest shall be signed. We already said that, right?
I think it's right that we did that.
And then I have project understanding and approach. I was thinking just strike that. I think it's going to be very, we already did all the stuff about scope.
Right, but that's, we're telling them what we want. This is sort of
us. It's fine. Yeah, it's fine.
To tell us what their approach would be.
If we want to leave it in, yeah. Then I had firm experience.
Instead of written discussion, written, like a summary.
Written just discussion, some, written.
A summary. It doesn't have to be anything long.
Yeah, sure, it's better, right?
Yeah.
In sufficient detail to demonstrate an understanding of the project. And the proposers, everywhere says proposers, we say investigators.
Yeah.
Anticipated approach to the investigation and review.
Period after investigation.
That's fine. Yeah, I mean, we titled the whole thing review, but it's, right. It's fine. I don't have to add it everywhere. From experience under that heading, please write a detailed written summary of the investigators' relevant background, education, qualifications, experience, capability, performance, anticipated scope of work. Fine.
It's fine.
Yeah. Staff planning qualifications, then by the personnel who will work on the investigation. Should I strike review there? It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And their roles and responsibilities. Provide information on the background, education, qualifications, experience, relevant to the project, resumes, or personnel. The difference between the two. The first one was talking about the firm, assuming we're talking
about the firm.
And then if the firm has 300 people in it, which ones are working on my project?
Right.
Because, so they might want to say, my firm has done these investigations,
mm-hmm.
but then you're like, that's great. How about the people who will be working on mine?
Right.
These things are going to be much streamlined than an individual.
Right. And this will be the firm thing wouldn't apply?
Yes.
Yeah.
Arbitrarily asked for 3 references. Ideally from similar projects, and have all the information you want from them. The last sentence, references to projects similar to the scope of services for this LOI, and should be recent. Provided, I've never called anybody with references on bids or anything that gave a bad reference.
Have you ever called a reference for a job then? Like, if you want to hire someone?
Yeah. Yeah. But do they ever get bad ones?
I've gotten some interesting feedback.
I've always like if they, you know, if somebody gets a contractor with a project and went south, they don't list that one, unless you happen to know about it.
Yeah.
Schedule, providing an anticipated schedule. I guess that's okay.
I think it's okay.
At least it'll give us a heads up of what they're thinking.
Mm-hmm.
By no means would that tie them in if they say, oh, I can get it done in 3 weeks.
Right.
And it takes them 3 weeks just to set up meetings with people. Fee proposal. Please submit the hourly rates for the personnel that will be involved in the investigation and review of any other charges proposed, for example, mileage, printing, etc. Please list these rates. And then I had, based on the anticipated scope of work, schedule, and proposed rate, please indicate an estimated total fee. Do you want to strike the last line? I was thinking we should at least ask for the rates. Is that may be a factor we might take into account, but it might be asking too much of them before they even get started. How much do you think the total is going to cost?
Yeah, I don't know.
I was thinking of striking that last part. If you want to leave it in, it's
fine. I'm sort of on the fence because I think that. We as a town have an interest in having this information sooner rather than later. I mean, again, not like so soon that it's not a real investigation, but I wonder if having just one thing that says, what do you think, what's your estimate for this?
I wrote it, but then I was thinking about it going, I don't even know how many people they're going to have to interview or how much effort,
right.
So I'm not sure if it's helpful. We can leave it in, because they're just going to say, based on what I know, here's what I think. The final number may be very good.
I mean, Herb, do you have an opinion on whether or not we should ask for an estimated total fee?
I think if you don't really have any idea what the range would be right now, it's going to be a complete yes.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's the decision you all have to make once you get the proposal.
Right.
And then, you know, see this one's high, this one's low, but this is the general range for whichever one fits. So I don't, I mean, I wouldn't say.
I think it's going to be very difficult for a respondent to provide an estimated number of hours and total fee that will be charged. And then if you request that, numbers come in and there's significant lower final bill list.
Right.
Something striking, because certainly should ask them their rates.
Right.
Because that might make a difference. If there's some great firm in Washington, D.C., but they charge $600 an hour plus all travel and hotel and restaurant expenses,
right.
We're going to take that into account because they're going to go through the money
really
pretty quickly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, so let's take it out. The last sentence.
Yeah.
That's going to be one of the data
points
in the decision-making process.
Right. So this isn't a bid. So they're just going to say, here's our rates. And at some point, they're going to have to, after we select which firm, they're going to have to, you know, sign an agreement with us. And at some point, we're going to tell them with the checking in with us. I mean, we need to know if you're going to go. $75,000 is going to come and go because it was left. Like, if we need more, we have to go back to the finance board, the town meeting, and they're going to want information on, well, what was done and what remains to be done. Not the specific findings, but why are you asking for more money?
Right. Are you halfway through? Or are you, you know, where are
right.
you? Yeah.
Yeah. Just a clarification on the process. You have not gotten board of finance approval.
We have approval for $75,000.
But it was the $75,000 was raised from what the initial number was. The initial number was just based on a wild assumption, and then they raised it based on another wild assumption. So I don't wanna limit somebody who thinks it's gonna be a little more than that and said, oh, I'm not gonna waste my time, they only have $75,000. I'm hoping they spend less than that. But right. I mean, it is a fact that anybody can find out.
Just the premises from there. I have not seen the documents you guys are working on, so I don't know if it's coming up, but you know, you may wish to interview some of the respondents.
Oh, yes,
yes.
That's in here. That's it. So, look, this thing's pretty good.
When you interview, that's one of the questions you ask. You'll have all that information. Make a decision.
So then the next section is currently titled Evaluation and Award. There's a section called Selection Criteria and Selection Procedures. And so I'll just say here's what I was thinking of doing. And if you want to leave this up in, it's not long, but in the interest of shortening it, I was thinking of striking most of the section because, you know, I stole it from another proposal for a different purpose. However, instead of the 6.1 or 6.2, just underneath, I would change the title to maybe something like evaluation, or LOI evaluation.
And just have
like two things under. Number one would be what is currently under the heading mandatory experience, but don't say mandatory. Just say number one would be the proposer must have experience performing similar investigation and reviews.
Okay, I'm okay with that. That they have, you know, the investigator
must have experience performing similar investigation and reviews.
Mm-hmm.
Like if this is the first one they did, we're probably not gonna.
Right, I agree.
And then I made up stuff about preferred experience. I'm like, maybe just don't even. Just because there were those headings under the previous thing I was following, the template I was following.
Right. I mean, we definitely don't care if they have investigation experience of criminal issues, because that's not relevant here.
Well, I mean, they may need to understand if they're communicating with the state police or DCF, but I was just thinking, just strike it. We're, the mandatory experience and the rest of it is just stuff that we consider when we're reviewing the
So strike B and strike C, do you want to just read them so people know what we're striking?
Yeah, preferred experience, the proposer should have knowledge of and experience with criminal investigations, education law, employment law, and standards and requirements applicable to after-school child care and park and recreation programs. If you want to leave it in, it's okay. It's just, I was trying to shorten it to like, what do we really need to mention under the evaluation criteria? It's not really long, it's just, when I read through it last night, I'm like, I didn't get rid of most of
it. Do you think that if we leave it in, it would turn a good candidate away for some reason?
Well, I mean, it was put in because you're trying to inform, you know, say an engineer, how you're going to review the thing. And then they know either what to focus on in their proposal, or also if they really don't have that kind of experience, then maybe don't waste anybody's time. But I don't know in this case if that stuff is really as critical as it implies by sticking it in there. I only put it in there because the template I was using had before experience. Mm-hmm. So I put in stuff mm-hmm. under there. So we don't have to delete it, but I was just suggesting that. Also suggesting deleting most of the rest of the section. The background education qualifications and relevant experience of key personnel to be assigned to the project. Also qualifications of any sub-consultants or subcontractors the proposer intends to use. Again, this is stuff we're doing. I don't know if we have to tell them that that's stuff that we're going to consider in the selection process. It's okay. It's almost we want to put it in, but I didn't know appropriate licenses,
right,
such as attorney held by a proposer staff, references attesting to the quality of similar services. This is not asking for it. We already asked for that information. Not saying we're going to consider it. But I was just saying strike all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
I did suggest, in addition to number one, the proposer must have experience performing similar investigation reviews, then have a number two, which just kind of has the legal clarifying stuff, which would be like the information currently under 6.2A.
Right.
The town reserves the right to reject any or all proposals, to accept any proposal, to negotiate any changes to proposal terms, to delete minor inconsistencies with the, in this case, LOI, if deemed in the best interest of the town, and then maybe adding after that, the last portion of this section beforehand, which is currently entitled G, I think. So not competitiveness of proposed fees and costs, but just say the town is not bound to select the proposal with the lowest fees and costs. The town reserves the right to negotiate fees with the selected proposer.
I don't even have that. I think I just deleted it.
Okay.
So
I was thinking of just adding it to the...
This one?
Yeah, not the first part. Not I wouldn't do
okay.
this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just going to start this with a capital. And then I would just bring this sentence down if we're making this another one.
Okay.
So I'm getting rid of the separate headings for selection criteria, selection mm-hmm. procedures. So we'd be striking proposals submitted in response to this RFP will be reviewed by the Board of Selectmen using the selection criteria listed above. Some or all proposers may be invited to an interview. We could put that in if we want, or just if that's what's going to develop. We invite them into an interview. If they refuse to come, then that's the end, right? The town intends to enter a contract with a firm whose proposal would be best. I think we can strike that. No, it's the end of it. So if you want to leave all the stuff in and tweak the language.
We could take out B.
The thing about the interview.
C? Is that C?
Yeah, so I was proposing changing it to like proposal evaluation, or I guess LOI evaluation in
okay.
this case. And then totally redoing under that, just having like item one, the proposer must have experience performing similar investigation and reviews.
Yeah. You don't want anything about preferred experience?
It's fine if you want to leave it in.
Would there be anything that you would add to that?
I think I would not, I would just make that number two, and then don't say mandatory experience or preferred experience, just because we said must have, then should have knowledge of an experience. But I don't know if that's really that important.
What if we said or instead of and?
Should have knowledge of or experience?
No, like there's a whole list of things, and if we said here or Park and Rec, like... Like here's a list. Like you should have some experience in
And usually when you say stuff under preferred, it means the fact that you don't have one of all of these isn't necessary. Exactly. So if you want to leave it in, fine. And then I don't know if we need to have the section C that says we're going to consider the stuff that we asked for. In
I don't think
proposal.
We need to. See.
Yeah. And then I missed letter
of
researches. And then you want licenses? This is just saying we're just considering it. We don't need to tell them what we're
saying. Yeah.
References, of course we're gonna take them into account. Why do you have to tell them you're gonna take them into account? Right? Right. So you wanna
we can take out the E and F, right?
Yeah.
And
It's not really
necessary to tell all the applicants that.
Yeah, I was just following the template.
No, I got it.
All right, so it's going to be LOI evaluation where we're going to take out the heading selection criteria. We're going to take out the thing that says A, manager experience, and just start with one. And then we're going to take out B, preferred experience, but then start with the sentence that we're both the investigator.
Yeah.
And then that's going to be item two. And item three is going to be
6.2a, right?
Yeah. Okay. Right. So again, we're going to take out the heading 6.2.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to take out the A's, B's, and C's.
Yeah.
We're going to have the town reserve the right to reject any offers, accept any proposal, negotiate changes. And then I think we should add back in the stuff that you had stricken out from the last part of that previous section. The town is not bound to select a proposal with lowest fees. Town reserves the right to negotiate fees. The town's not bound. And then we're definitely going to strike the next thing. Proposals submitted will be reviewed by the Board of Selectmen.
Yeah, we that's just obvious, right?
Do you want to have the sentence that some or all proposers may be invited to an interview?
Either way, I'm okay with that. Yeah, we could even.
That'll be number five.
Okay.
And then I don't think we intend to enter a contract.
No.
The only other thing that wasn't listed and that we might want to add to this part, do we want to make it clear that there'll be no payment for. No payment for responding for the responses to the letter of interest or attendance at interviews. Or it should be understood that before you're hired, you're not.
I think it's understood.
Okay.
I mean, I think if we get a bill, that would be my fault, right? So we're almost done, but I wanted to ask about sort of like the fact that, you know, this is sort of a unique situation we're in, and we can get responses, we can get, you know, mail, like we're going to announce that's the way to respond to this. It's going to be posted. If anyone knows of anyone that might be interested or a good candidate, then please spread the word. And wanted to talk to you a little bit about what do we do for, what should we do in terms of like, I didn't get to this yet either. Is this going to be an attachment? Well, anyway, one thing
I think because of very specific, I haven't even read it, but very specific questions. I mean, I think it may be that we should reference it in the scope of work and say, but we have those general ones. A list of some questions that have been asked by townspeople is attached for information.
Okay, so I want to read some of this because we don't have copies for anyone.
Yeah.
And I want to just say that my other question is about how do we handle the fact that some entities, maybe law firms who would be good at this type of investigation, they're not going to see a legal notice or a notice anywhere and say, oh, let me send in a letter of interest. So what, and I've gotten recommendations from people in town, and I know Vin has someone that he wants us to look at.
I thought he had, so he had listed.
Yeah, I know,
he had listed a bunch of law firms, and he mentioned an attorney who, like, had been in law enforcement, but he had some names.
FBI.
There were some names that were handed to me at the town meeting by one of the attendees.
Yeah.
I think those were not attorneys. I gave those to Attorney Marino. But basically, so I was thinking if Jen was going to be the one managing the notice, that she would get all the lists that Attorney Marino had, they would get individual notification of the RFP or RFP sent to them.
This is how it usually posted.
Well, I assume there's going to have to also be like a New Haven Register legal ad, I think is the way they do it. They also put it on the website, but that's not really.
CCM, they also have a bid posted.
We can use that too, but I'm pretty sure for their other things they do, the register is the legal notice. So usually you put it in there, that's posting. Any other postings are fine, I mean, you're trying to get as much interest, and then you have to individually invite anyone you know who might be. I know Attorney Marino had mentioned some law firms, he rattled them off, like, I know one was Coleman and Conley, you might have said Bertram and Moses.
Yes.
There was one.
The FBI guy.
No, but there was a firm in a Hartford-based firm. You said Chipman and Goodwin, that there was a different one.
Chipman and Goodwin was recommended to me by two or three people. And
so I think it should
be. How many counties in Hartford? Oh, they're all over, I guess.
I thought they were in the brief. They're different offices. Mm-hmm. There was a different one where you mentioned the attorney by name, but he was part of a bigger firm. Anyway, so he rattled off, he had like six or something at the time. So we want to get those, the three that somebody handed me, and any other ones you and I come up with that would be receive invitations or receive notice of this, be sent a copy of this or let them know how to get it. Then there needs to be some kind of a legal ad placed. It really has to be done by town staff. I'm thinking I should be doing that. So really it's just going to be the title and then maybe just this intent. Right.
The section.
Or maybe just the title, and then referring them to the website or something, or because.
Right.
I mean, is it all right to?
Maybe.
Publish a notice that you're soliciting petitions to respond. Refer them to the website.
Yeah.
Or an office here in town hall to pick up the physical.
All right, so there's going to be a newspaper, a legal notice, just saying Town of Bethany, request for letters of interest, independent investigation and review, and then providing the where they can get the form.
Yes. And I don't want to interrupt the flow, but there are, I think, two provisions you should be adding to the proposal.
The mechanics are also going to be any firms or individuals that Attorney Marino has or that we come up with would then need to be notified by phone or email. And then who should handle that? The town attorney, the town staff?
I think you and I should do that. You take half, I'll take half.
Okay. I think it's better if it's done by town staff, but.
I want to do it, so I think we should do it.
All right. Well, we don't want them to be communicating with us, though. We have to make it the firms. You should just be. I really think it should be somebody, not us.
Why?
Because we're the selection committee. Why are they communicating with us?
I don't understand that. I don't understand. What is there a problem or a conflict with that?
I don't know. I just, it's kind of highly unusual to have somebody outside of town hall handling the recusal.
Right, but in this situation, Paula is recused and she supervises everybody here. So that's, I think that's a problem.
We're getting back to the problem of it. It's, I mean, you and I cannot pay these people and all that stuff. I mean, you can't do this completely outside of the town.
Well, we can do as much as we can.
All right, so we will have to obtain these names from Attorney Marino and any other ones. The list of who they're sent to should be compiled somehow. Right?
Yes. So we need
So if we don't trust anybody in the town, so you will have to tell me everyone you contacted, and I will tell you the ones I contacted.
Or we could have a list, and we could divide it and say you call these people and call these people.
Right, but if I know somebody else, I have to let you know that they're kind of that I contacted, right?
Well, I mean, I don't know. Are we going to leave this meeting and start calling people?
No, because the edits we made have to be compiled, and we have to, I assume, have another meeting.
Yeah, I think we need a master list of the
who's going to be notified.
Who's going to be notified, and then we could, you know, maybe at the next meeting decide. You know, you call these three. I'll call these three. You call these six
so
or seven.
At the next meeting, we have to have those names.
Mm-hmm.
You can get from your law firm the ones that have been identified. And then if there's any other names that we're going to...
I would suggest if you wish to solicit this directly, send a letter.
Okay.
All right.
Yeah, Gina, I really think that it would be better if we had town staff do this and just inform us.
I didn't feel comfortable with that. Like, who in town, who do you want to do that?
Leslie, but you're just not that many people.
But I'm just trying to, I hear you. I'm just trying to figure out how this works because these are people who call as supervisors. So how do
again,
we know?
You're not saying the words, but you're saying no one in town hall can be trusted with any of this.
No, I'm not saying that at all. I'm saying how do you not cross the line of the recusal?
Cool. Not everyone is recused, right?
I think if Paul is recused,
so you're worried that she's going to come in and lean over the shoulder and go, don't send it to that firm. Lie and tell to say you did.
I don't know. I mean, she got involved in the agenda.
Okay.
So, which is,
I mean, can the town attorneys notify the people that they know and just let us know who they notified? Or do we have to do it personally?
I mean, I think that's fine.
I think they're going to think it's a little weird. They're like, why is Robert Brittany sending me a letter? I don't know who this person is, you know?
Yeah, but
it's not on letterhead or anything, it's just...
We can get letterhead.
But we're just doing it as individuals. We could do it that way, it just seems a little weird that we... I think you're making it more difficult than necessary by making out everyone in town hall is corrupt.
Bob, okay, I want to say, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is
say
that I've seen actual evidence of Paula's inability to act in a way that shows she understands what recusal means over and over again. And so, yes, I have concerns of what happens when I'm not here. And I'm not making this up, right? Many times we've seen where she's at the table and she comments on the issue when she's recused, or she insists that the agenda has to be her way when she's not here and is recused. Why does the agenda have to be written her way? So if I haven't seen this evidence of her inability to act like she understands what it means to be recused from an issue, I would behave differently, and I would agree with you, and I would be grateful for Jen's support or whoever else. But I guess I feel uncomfortable with someone who openly defies that recusal and acts contrary to that recusal and hasn't recused from a more obvious conflict than this. Yes, I have concerns about her understanding of where the lines are. And there's evidence all over the place to support my concern. So I agree with you that it would be easier if we can do it that way. There's no doubt it would be easier. And that's why, you know, if our attorneys want to help us with that, I'm happy to do that.
All right. So would you be okay with the town attorney sending out notification? The notification is going to be generic, right? It just has to be, you know, this is to notify, or just sending the whole document. If it's not going to be that long, right?
Oh, this thing?
Yeah.
I don't think
that one. So either that or just a very short letter that says documents available at the website, and then providing us with a list of who was notified?
I would love to see a draft letter, just the template letter.
Okay.
So if that's okay.
So the mechanics are...
I can handle that. I would just add, you guys spend a lot of time seasoning, stressing, this needs to be independent. I agree.
Thank
the
you.
Perception of either of you calling select firms and then potentially being awarded an outcome not desirable to anyone in the populace creates an appearance of
it. It's interesting how you, I think you're right about that, but it's interesting how our attorneys are so quick to notice a potential conflict in this instance, but not in other instances that are more flagrant. I'm just saying that I don't need you to answer. I just want to say that.
So a legal ad will be drafted for the next meeting, and a generic notification letter, which will be mailed to a list of firms and individuals, and that list should also be available for the next meeting, so that we can review it and then potentially add to it. And then, at least as at this point, we will assume that town staff will place the legal ad, unless we want to pay for it ourselves. And then the notification will be done by the town attorney's firm, and let us know that that was done. The stuff we went through today, I think, needs to be typed up and. Just to make sure it's all done.
And
just to incorporate all the edits, and then again, that would be sent to both of us prior to the next meeting, so that we can just approve the final request for letter of interest, as it's been edited tonight, and then we've got that process. You had brought up. There's a series of questions that you have, and there may be, I think in the beginning, we're open to receiving additional ones until that is finalized. But I think all of these extremely specific things, we should probably put a reference in the scope of work. Under the background section, we'll be listed a couple of general questions, and then maybe there just say,
yes.
A non-inclusive list of of questions that members of the public have asked is attached.
Right.
Information.
And so this was that way at the beginning of the meeting where we talked about background, and then we had examples of questions that we remembered from town meetings, and we read them, and I think there were 9. And I just had, and some of these might be a duplicate. So you're saying that it would be like an addendum?
Yeah, and then because you left it open, people can submit additional questions, which would then be added to that.
Right.
And I guess it's probably fine to even have a duplicate. This is
right.
This is not necessarily, I am animal.
It's
this
not
is not necessarily your scope of work. It's just answer these questions and you're done.
Right.
But under the background section we had like 9 questions. And then before the last paragraph, which explains the refusal of the first selectman, insert some kind of a line that says a list of additional questions that have been asked by members of the public is attached for reference, something like that.
Right, because it's the whole point of this investigation is that people have these questions. I want to read the questions for the record, but before I do that, I just want to clarify. So are we saying that a letter will go out to the firms or individuals that we've identified, is it a letter or a phone call?
I think he's suggesting written.
Written. I would suggest it write an email or a letter.
The other thing is, we did have in here, and it would be, we can adjust it for the final, but before it goes out, we will have to say when the deadline is.
Right.
It'll probably depend on when we're gonna approve the final.
Well, we have a couple options. We could look at the date of the next regular meeting, or we can schedule another special
meeting. Next regular meeting is, it's, I know it's not next week, 2 weeks out? So.
It's like 3 weeks. So it's September, is it the 3rd?
That sounds right. Second is Labor Day, right?
Right.
So do we want to wait that long? And there'll be other items on the agenda, so we would not have a lot of time to put into this.
Do you want to do a special meeting?
No, but I guess we have to. Maybe the last week of August?
That works for me. Do you want to do a Thursday again?
Yeah, I think when I was talking at the town clerk's office, the way meetings work is most people prefer the beginning of the month, so there's very little going on. So we could, I think we could reserve this room again.
Okay.
Do you want to, oh, I cannot do the 29th.
Okay.
No, the meeting I went to before, they scheduled another meeting.
How about
what's that?
No.
How about the 28th?
28th should be okay, Wednesday. Yeah, this is like the last week of the month. I don't think anything's on 4th. I'm okay with that.
Okay.
At what time? We can do it earlier than 7:30.
6:30?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. I'm going to do a 6:30. Six. So we'll have to have a notice sent out. Special meeting. And it'll be just like tonight, right? It's just going to be that one.
Yeah, just one item. And, you know, I don't know if I have to make a motion to strike the term request for proposals, but that's what I'd like to do.
Yeah, make a letter of interest now.
I don't even know if I like that. But
unless you don't get something better, to say that.
All right. And it's all over the draft. It's all over the draft.
Yeah. Special board session at 6:30 on Wednesday, August 28th.
We'll have public comment related to the investigation if anyone has.
Exactly. Yeah, pretty much exactly the same as tonight. Except changing that RFP.
Thank you.
Hopefully. Even if it says RFP, so it's still fine for notice.
It's not though. It's not an RFP.
I know it provides people know what we're talking about.
I think it's confusing.
So that's the date we will have a special meeting, and hopefully prior to that time we'll have revised these edits. We'll get a list of the firms to be notified from the town attorney's office.
Okay.
And I don't have any other ones other than the names of three.
I have a couple. That one person gave me a slip of paper at a meeting, and I don't think I have it, but I'll get it together for next time. So I have to
get it ahead of time.
And have
we can get people passed on to the one list.
Yeah, we'll miss.
Just want to make sure that you guys put in the qualifications that they demonstrate adequate insurance coverage. General professional.
All right, should we put that in? This is a request for letter of interest. In that last
qualification section, that they have to demonstrate to you that they believe they're qualified, they should demonstrate that it's insurance.
Last section where we have some legal stuff for, like, we don't have to put this. So
we have five, right? We have five, we can add six.
Add six. So what do we want to say that?
What general liability coverage, probably $1 million, professional practice, $1 million, workers' comp per statute, require umbrella, that's probably not necessary.
The selected phone. Should we get information from the finance director, or is that, do they say, the selected firm or individual? will be required to provide evidence of required insurance, and then we'll insert the language. So I'm sure she's got minimum coverage amounts for different categories.
Okay, thank you. That's a great suggestion.
Right. You said you have two things, right?
Oh yeah, the other one, and I thought that on this, you should have somewhere in there that town, you know, doesn't discriminate. Process, you know, yes.
Do you have to say that?
Probably.
Boilerplate.
It hurts.
I agree.
Unless you find it.
So, well, we are going to
do this. Would you advise us to do that?
We're only going to choose one firm, so. Standard non-discrimination language.
I'll put that in there.
That's fine, yeah. As soon as anybody reads it, they just ignore it anyway, because they already know what it says. Individual evidence of insurance. I'm just going to make a note to get from that. So. So if you're doing the typing, right?
Yeah, it's
once you get it done, you send it out. We'll request these things. Have a meeting in just under 2 weeks, right?
Yes.
And hopefully, then that will be finalized, and then at that meeting we can. Well, if we do finalize on the 28th, you want to pick what the due date would be. You have to give people a certain amount of, like, if we do that in the evening, right? It's not going to get in the register until like the 30th at the earliest. And the letters won't get there until next Monday. I assume you want to give people a couple of weeks to put things together. Maybe it shouldn't take that long. But anyway, so are we going to want to do a special meeting or deal with it on the 8th? No, it's on the 1st of October. Maybe we should do a special meeting if problem with doing a regular meeting if there's a big agenda,
right.
It's 11:30 at night.
Right, I agree.
So we will do an opening. Although we can do the opening, we're just gonna have to take all the if there's one, it makes it easy. But if there's 10 submissions, we're just gonna take them home and review them.
Right.
So maybe we should do a special meeting prior to that one to try to accelerate the process. Looking maybe at towards the end of the third week of September or beginning of the fourth week to give the people. It's just, I think the way we have it written, or no, that's when we would get the, that's when we would ask the response for, right? We have to give them at least 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks. So when would we ask for the response for, and then we would be having a meeting after that when they would be formally opened? You want them to submit it by, say, 4 p.m. on September 18th?
Are we going to be ready for that?
No, that just means it has to be received at the town hall by that date. Or do you want to have it be the date that we're opening it is the deadline date? You could have that in the case too.
Can we just decide that in at our next meeting?
You can.
Yeah, because I think. Yeah, I think we better hold on that.
So that'd be to be determined. Deadline for submission, and then when we're going to. I mean, we can't set the. If we're not making it at the same time, you could.
You're saying deadline for submission meeting, people have to send us their.
It could be the same time as we have a meeting, or it could be, look, you got to have it in by this date on Wednesday.
Right.
And if it's not postmarked that day, you're late.
Yeah.
If we don't have a deadline, then.
Right. No, we need to definitely. It's just hard because I don't know, like, when our attorneys are going to be available to, you know, what have the list and send stuff out, what their workload
yeah,
is.
Yeah, that should be done ahead of time. But anyway, so we have the meeting for August 28th,
yeah.
And we'll hopefully finalize it, and then it can go out and be advertised.
So I just want to read the addendum that...
this is my copy?
Yeah, yeah. So, it's, you know, it's really just, you know, notes that I had for meetings and public meetings and comments people made about why this investigation is, what sorts of answers they wanted. And the general theme, I think, is that, like, we really shouldn't complicate it, right? People really want to know basic things, basic answers to questions like, and again, some of this is repetitive, I apologize, but who was told in December 2022? What were they told? What did they do in response to that information? What has been done since? What were policies, procedures, and trainings of Park and Rec at that time? When, if ever, did the policies, procedures, and trainings change? What did Paula know? When did she know it? Did she speak with the state police? If so, when? Was she actually told not to tell anyone about the investigation that came to light in December of 2022? If so, by whom? When? When did she tell the town attorney? When did she tell the Board of Selectmen? Would she have been in violation of any law if she had issued a vague statement in December of 2022? I put it in there again.
This is a list of
questions
that people have had. So this
yeah.
is a... I mean, it's like a quote. You say,
yeah.
you don't have
right,
edit
right.
people's quotes. Yeah.
Was she involved in the continued employment of Anthony Mastrangelo after December 2022? When did she ask for a review of Park and Rec protocols, if at all? Did she speak with Anthony M. or his mother about this? Did she notify anyone at Park and Rec about alleged abuse? Why was Anthony M. hired by her husband's insurance firm? What did Janice actually know, and when did she know it? What did the superintendent tell her? Did she speak with Anthony? I think that question meant Anthony Profrancesco, but I'm not sure. I'm just looking at my notes.
And then the next one, it was...
was she ordered to keep Anthony on as an employee? Why didn't she send out a letter to Park and Rec families? Why did she not insist on having social workers, trainings, et cetera, for parents and kids age appropriate after December 2022? What about BCS? Should this be added to the investigation review or scope? What was the superintendent told? What did she do? When did she tell Paula? Did she speak to Janice? Why didn't she send out a notice to BCS parents? Something could have been sent out. Why didn't she offer counseling for parents or students after December 2022? Did she know Anthony M. was still working at Park and Rec, be away from the school after December 2022? What about Anthony Profrancesco? What was he told and when was he told it? He has already admitted that he was aware that Anthony M. was under investigation. Even when he was working at Park and Rec after December 2022, did he have conversations with other counselors? What and when? And what was his training? So this is just the accumulation of notes and meetings and to be added as examples of questions that residents in town had and are hoping for answers from the investigation.
I think that the number one should be stricken. It's not a
question. Oh, it's not a question. Yeah. I'll take that out. That's my note to myself,
And then the second one, maybe take out, don't complicate it. I mean, we need answers to basic questions
right.
is fine.
Yeah.
And in terms of this, I don't think you have to be that worried about capitalization and stuff like that.
Did I not capitalize?
Well, there's a few gaps, but I mean, it's fine for, you're trying to give them... Yeah.
Okay, I'll do it.
I'm
going to do it.
But then, what about BCS? ? Is fine. And then add it to the investigation and review scope. That's not really a question for them.
Yeah.
You can leave the add it to BCS if you want, either ones. But the rest are all
just questions. And just so people know, the first two lines that I wrote to myself that Bob suggested that I strike was the draft, this draft may be too broad and the scope too much. Don't complicate it. And so that's going to be removed. It just ramblings as I was.
Yeah, so it should all, it's just a series of questions that you just read. And then if, I guess if you receive other ones in the interim and they're not duplicative, we could add them to this attachment. Mm-hmm. To really, to give anybody who's not familiar with it a background in general, what is the town looking for them to look into?
Right. What were people asking it, especially at that first meeting where it was news, it was new and people were upset. And these are the kinds of things that people have been asking since that day.
We're calling this an addendum or an attachment.
Yeah. Or attachment, probably.
Yeah. And then you said you have copies of the arrest reports because those have to
I
be,
do, yeah.
If they're not available online, we have to attach them.
I'll
there's a lot of information in there that would be hard to, I guess they're all available in the court files, but it's better if we make it an attachment. Then. So those attachment one is be like attachment two.
Okay. Attachment one is all five.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, that's all the information that the media reports, and if anybody went to the website at the time, they would have seen those things, and then that's the knowledge that the public was aware of at that time. I think we're in pretty good shape.
Okay.
Anything else you want to cover tonight?
I don't think so. Anything else you want to cover?
No, there's just a little homework. You're doing some typing. We're getting that list from the attorney.
The only thing, as I go along, do we resolve every single issue, or do we say we'll go back to something?
But we did. I mean, because I remember the beginning, the background, I was suggesting we strike the rest of it, but I did say, I was saying I think you could shorten it, but you wanted to leave it in, and I'm fine with that.
All right. Do you mind if I think about it?
No.
Okay.
Yeah, I was just trying to shorten it and saying, maybe I'm going a little too far with, I wrote down things that I had heard, but then I'm like, should I even be like, putting all this stuff down and telling the investigator, because I don't know that it's all true. So that was the only reason I was going to try to shorten it up a little bit. But if you want to leave it in, they're all clarified as reportedly.
Right.
That's all they are, stuff that was reported to me.
Mm-hmm.
And
so now what do we do, a motion to adjourn?
I'm okay with that.
I was going to ask, did you make a motion to amend the item on tonight's agenda proposals to be letters of interest?
Yeah. I think you need to make a motion for next agenda.
Right.
I
think the only, it's just we're not taking action on the finalizing the LOI tonight, right? It's, we're still in draft.
Yeah, I think
adjournment is the next item.
I wanted to change this agenda because it's.
Yeah. Huh? Change the special meeting.
Why not?
So, it's already been posted.
Well, all right. Well, then the next agenda isn't going to say that, right?
Well, I'm not putting it out, but I will make it clear that you wanted
Thank
to say
you.
Letters.
I appreciate
interest.
It. It's just such a minor thing. I don't understand why such, pushback. I have a question for just one question for the attorneys. Does the procurement policy have anything to do with this project here?
Not right, Stephanie's procurement.
But in your experience in general, are we bound by the procurement policy and the work that we're doing?
Generally, when you're hiring a professional, like a lawyer or something, you're open to hire whoever you want and not required to follow like a minimum bid.
Thank you. Do you want a copy? I have it right here. You can have it if you want.
You'd like me to review it? Sure.
Oh no, I don't want to give you like work. I think you have enough on your plate. So, but if you want it for the file, I have it here.
Yeah, even if it is the town, the 4 seconds can waive bids. Did you do that?
No, I mean, I just think.
And waive the process, even if it were the process for professional services. Yeah, you wouldn't want to do bidding for professional services. I just don't know how you want to take money into account. But, you know, I don't think you want to hire the cheapest doctor, the cheapest attorney.
I just think it's strange that a simple request to make the agenda more accurate was the response was a refusal to.
It's just illegal to change.
No, I'm talking about before the meeting. I asked for. It wasn't set. It was not set. It was being worked on. And I, instead of cooperating, I was told that it had to be an RFP, and they sent me the procurement policy. And it's just unfortunate that even a small little request like that is met with resistance from someone who's recused. And, you know, it's unfortunate because it doesn't, it's not consistent with someone who's been recused.
Not a big deal, no.
I mean, I think it's a big deal. I think if you're recused, you should be recused. And if you're recused,
in terms of this thing, I think it provided sufficient information that people knew what we were meaning about.
I just wanted people to know what happened and the resistance I got on a very simple request. So.
I would like to adjourn.
Do you want to make a motion?
I would love to. I will adjourn. Time is 10.
I second.
10:08 maybe?
I second the motion.
On favor?
Hi. Thank you.
See you in 2 weeks.
I don't know why people think you're not a nice guy.
I have never heard that from anyone except you. You asked me when I'm going to start mean. I'm like, I don't think anyone's ever called me mean.
I didn't say
except
mean.
Except maybe Paula. But
recording stopped.